The second talk, my second talk is about the triangles, consisting of information, especially the sum of the inner angle of triangles. So, let us start with the most simple case, Euclidean geometry. In this case, the sum of the inner angles of a triangle is always pi. However, the value of the sum depends on the geometry. In the case of the spherical triangles and hyperbolic triangles, the sum is dependent on the area. Therefore, sum of inner angles depends on the nature of the space where the triangle is located. Let us imagine a triangle of information. In the field of information theory, information is related to probability distribution. I draw three types of information in the slide by assuming that all the information is Gaussian. There may be distances between all pairs because the characters of the information are different. So we can imagine a triangle of information. Three points in the parameter space represent their information. So we can discuss the shape of a triangle obtained by connecting the vertices in the space. However, the shortest curve connecting the two points, called the geodesic line, may not be straight. So what is the sum of the what value of the sum of the inner angles? Therefore, the goal of this presentation is to discuss these two subjects. One is that how I obtain the values of the sum, and the other is the relation between my talk and the objectives of this conference. And I think that the latter is impossible. However, I want to discuss about the results of my calculations. And I should note that I found mistakes of my calculations during the presentation of this talk. So I want to change my result in the abstract. I wrote that the sum of the triangles of Gaussian triangles is pi over 2. However, the value is greater than or equal to pi, as I will show in the following. The rest of my presentation consists of two parts. Firstly, I will explain short summary of information geometry of exponential family. And then I will explain about the calculations of the sum of the inner angles in parameter spaces, focusing on two cases, Gaussian distributions and discrete distributions. So let's move on to the first part, short summary of information geometry. Amari wrote in his pioneering book that a method of exploring the information geometry is a method of exploring the world of information by means of modern geometry. From my viewpoint, information geometry is a method to analyze relations of information by using differential geometry on manifold. I will focus our consideration on two cases, Gaussian distribution and discrete distribution. Both distributions are the representative when we discuss about the probabilities. In the case of this discrete distribution, the second part here, we start the subscript of the list of probabilities from zero. This is a common treatment in the field of information geometry. Therefore, the n equals 1 represents coin tossing, and n equals 2 represents the probabilities consist of three elements here. Maybe this is corresponding to the dice consisting of 2 ones, 2s, and 3s. Here, I introduce a concept of exponential family. Probability distributions belonging to this family can be represented by using these formulas. Both of Gaussian distribution and discrete distributions belong to this group. Also, I want to skip the details of the equations. I emphasize that the parameter and DR affine parameter are important factors in order to calculate the inner angles, this part and this part. This is the representation of Gaussian distributions, the parameter space of Gaussian distribution. This consists of mu squared over sigma squared and negative 1 over 2 sigma squared. And the DR affine parameter here consists of mu and mu squared plus sigma squared. Note that the original parameter of Gaussian distribution is mu and sigma. However, in order to according with the formulation of information geometry or exponential family, the parameter space is changed. We changed to this type. And this is a representation of discrete distributions. The parameter is logarithm of p sub I, and the dual affine parameter is probability itself. Here, I want to mention about KL divergence, Kullback-Leibler divergence. This function can be regarded as the square of the distance intuitively. As I wrote in the slide, in the parameter space, we cannot obtain the distance between two points because the geodesic lines are different between from P to Q and from Q to P. So in information geometry, the KL divergence, the function referred to as divergence is frequently used. In the case of the exponential family, it is proved that the KL divergence is derived naturally. I mean that KL divergence is suitable measure for exponential family to judge the distance between two points. And this formula shows the explicit form of KL divergence. And only I want to emphasize is that when we exchange P and Q, then the formula changes. I mean that by exchanging P to, by replacing Q to P here and here, and by replacing P to Q, then the formula becomes different one. This means that the distance from P to Q and the distance from Q to P is not the same. This is very important point in the following discussion. The generalized Pythagorean theorem is one of the famous theorems in information geometry. This equation becomes true if orthogonality at Q is satisfied. It should be noted that the order of argument is important. And okay, I want to show by using mouse. Here we assume that orthogonality satisfies. And then we measure the square of KL divergence as a square of distance from QP and from P to Q and from Q to P, from Q to R, and sums this and add these two values. Then we also measure the square of distance KL divergence from P to QR. Then the generalized Pythagorean theorem satisfies. And if we measure from R to P and replace the measure with this measure, then the equality is not satisfied. Therefore, one problem arises. Are the two sums of the inner angles in clockwise PQR and PRQ and counterclockwise PQR different or not? If the values are the same, then we can ignore the we have to calculate only one of these. However, if they are different, we have to calculate both of the values. So I have to consider about the measuring of inner angles precisely. This is, in the proof of the generalized Pythagorean theorem, orthogonality is defined as the equation written in black. And by extending this definition simply, the equation written in blue is the will be the definition of the inner angles. However, as I mentioned about the KL divergence, the measure of clockwise and counterclockwise is different. So the same definition, similar definition of the inner angle by using the different direction of the order is possible. And the green, the equation in green is the another candidate of the definition of inner angle. So I tried some numerical calculations of by using both definitions and obtained some numerical results. Okay, this is the first case, Gaussian distributions. I consider the simplest cases, that is the triangles of N01, N11, and N1 sigma sub 3. This is correspond the plot on the left shows the relation. Okay, N01, N11, and the blue one is N sigma 3. And by changing the value of sigma 3, we obtained the sum of inner angles. And the result is here on the right. The black line shows the cases of N01, N11, N1 sigma 3, this. And blue line corresponding to the another cases N01, N1 sigma 3, and N11. The difference is only the order of the choosing the vertices. I mean that one is for clockwise and the other is for counterclockwise. And the result shows that the value of the values changes rapidly around unity here. And it seems that the two values, black and blue, becomes very close around unity. This is because the order of the order has changed around here, around here. For example, this black line shows shows clockwise, and then the black line becomes counterclockwise. So the clockwise, the sum of the clockwise changes to blue in this case. Okay, so sum of the inner angle is seems to be dependent on the direction of the not only the configuration of the vertices but also the orders of the choosing the vertices. So I calculated the mean value of the two sums. I mean that once I calculate the inner angles of clockwise, then I also calculate the counterclockwise, the inner angles of counterclockwise, and obtain the mean value of these two values. And this is the results of the three cases written in here. Firstly, the sum is dependent on the configurations, the points on the parameter space. However, the maximum value seems to be corresponding to the similarity of the three distributions. And on the other hand, minimum value seems to be pi in two cases, and in the last cases, the value goes to pi if we take more larger value of sigma sub 3. So I tried to calculate the mean value for 20,000 random triangles. And the maximum value, not the maximum, the values dependent on the configuration of three points in the parameter spaces. However, the minimum value seems to be greater than or equal to pi. And this is the second case. First of all, that in the case of n equals to 1, this corresponds to the coin tossing. In this case, sum of inner angle is always becomes pi without the in both of the clockwise and counterclockwise. And in case of n equals to, this means that the tossing, throwing dice, which faces consists of two ones and two twos and two threes. And in this case, as shown in the left, in the right, the mean value of the sum changes and depends on the value of the depends on the configurations. I also tried the random triangle. I also generated random triangles number that is number of 50,000 and tried to the examine the value. This also the value is dependent on also configurations. However, the minimum value seems to be pi in both cases. Okay, let me summarize my talk. In the case of Gaussian distributions, the sum of the value is greater than or equal to pi. And it seems that the sum represents some nature of the triangles. And in the cases of discrete distributions, for n equal to 1, corresponding to coin tossing, the sums were always pi. And for n equal to 2 and n equal to 3, the sums were greater than or equal to pi. That's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Takashi. Thank you. You know, your presentation was a bit too technical, so I'm not sure if I can comment.
Yes, very technical.
Anything. So.
sorry.
But I enjoyed it very much. Does anyone has a question? Probably Dennis or so. I can't hear you, Dennis. Can't hear you.
Continue.
I have always a question, but anyway, my question that I like very much is generalization of the Pythagorean theorem. And it is amazing that clockwise and counterclockwise gives a different value. Mm-hmm. So I should like to discuss with you later, but not now, but because it is too technical. Mm-hmm. Is it not required that the clockwise and the counterclockwise results should be the same? So what is the meaning of this, that this is different?
Mainly that this means that the in most cases the geodesic line between two points is different.
Good. Yes. You answer. Yes.
Okay. Does anyone have a question for Takashi? It's not that we don't want to question, we are afraid to question Takashi. let me just ask an ignorant question. In spherical geometry, for strictly spherical geometry, for two geodesics to be orthogonal, they have to be great circles of the sphere, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I was just thinking in my head and confirming what you said.
I wanted to connect similar to the spherical geometry and the hyperbolic geometry.
Hyperbolic, yes.
Yes, yes. In the case of parameter space, there seems to be something the relation between the area and the sum of inner angles. However, I could not calculate the area because nobody defines the area in the parameter space.
I don't know. Is it an open problem in mathematics then?
Yes.
Okay. So you have to search a little more to find it yourself. Good luck with that.
That is very complicated.
I imagine.